Right, hello, welcome to episode 28 of the Sisyphus Complex Solution, and this week's is called Ministry of Truth. And if you remember after last week, and that I'd gone through the progress report, so now that I'm moving into the Department for Culture, no, hang on, Digital Culture, Media and Sport, something like that. So now I'm going to start going into the offices within that, and I'll go through three of them. There's a key reason why I've got Ministry of Truth that will become apparent in the second office that I run through. I did actually state as well that I've got an automatic disposition when it comes down to this particular office that I would love to just destroy the whole thing, because a lot of the narrative around culture, and as I demonstrated last week, and that the fact that there's an awful lot of this censorship and whatever, and some of the more rather insidious activities that are being undertaken towards gathering information on the citizenry is being done directly through this department. So I would love to be able to just say, no, get rid of the whole lot. But once you do start getting into the details, you know, there has to be some practicality, there has to be some realism, so that you don't fall into the same mistake that the ideologues that are causing so much devastation at the moment, that you don't fall into the same trap and basically do precisely what they're doing. So I'm going to try as much as I possibly can to be objective where it's possible. So we'll see how that one goes. Obviously, I will pick up as things go along. If I do come across any sort of particular statements or any new information that is coming in external to the basic investigation into this particular ministerial department and all of the offices that lay underneath their control. But just to give, I have previously given some examples as to people within other offices that are quite plainly falling into the same trap. So, like I said, there's the various stuff that's coming out of that business, energy and industrial strategy. There's been the outright statements that we know to be untrue from that Kemi Badenoch, who said that critical race theory and that was not going to be acceptable in this country, and yet you find that the two largest purveyors of that particular ideology and that are funded largely by the government. So it literally is this doublespeak, or a case of saying something in direct contravention to what it is that they're actually doing. And so it isn't just the culture side of things where that is taking place. I mean, like I say, I mean, this is the true virus, the ideology virus that has got through to so many different departments. A recent one over the last week or so in the UK, obviously, from a department that you kind of also come to expect now, and that was this Gavin Williamson, who's the Secretary of State for Education, and he's come out with the platitudes around free speech in universities, that if any university is found to be preventing freedom of speech or anything of that nature, and that then it will have a financial impact to them. But what they tend to be assuming, that everybody that is not able to actually see, hear and think, they're assuming that such people don't exist, because we know that when you've had a party that's in charge of the country for 10 years now, and that has just idly sat by and not only allowed that kind of activity to take place, but fundamentally actually promoted it and enabled it. So this particular individual turning around and saying that the indoctrination camps that they have helped create are going to be penalised again if they are against freedom of speech in any way is literally I can't remember what the expression. I mean, I know there's the one expression of speaking with forked tongue, but it's like speaking. I can't remember what the expression is now. It's like speaking out of two mouths from the same head, or something like that. But I can't remember exactly what it is. It doesn't really matter. You're gonna get the you get the understanding. That doesn't matter what they say. They're doing the exact. The typical socialists, they will literally say something that then that they are doing, and tell you to your face that they're not doing it. I think the main example I've always used on this is that they would walk up to you with a knife in their hand and stab you whilst telling you that they're not stabbing you. This is exactly what these people do. So I've got no interest in what this Gavin Williamson has been saying, or anybody else in government for that matter. Speaking of which, I have thought about putting this into this week's episode, but decided against it. But I've had my latest little correspondence come through, which is another little government letter from my local moron, turning around telling me how the government has got no plans for there to be a COVID-19 vaccinations to be mandatory, and no plans for there to be a immunity passport. Now, no plans is not what I asked, because what I'd stated is that because he's my local MP, I don't care what he thinks, and I don't care what government plans are. My information to this particular fella, Craig McKinley, was I was giving him a direct instruction. Under no circumstances do you vote for any kind of implementation of these kinds of activities. So I wasn't asking for the usual get out kind of terminology. I was asking for, here's the instruction, you're the public servant, you're not the public master, you're the public servant, here's the instruction, do it. But yep, you get the usual bullshit that comes back. So yeah. And a load of crap about, oh, we've been so lucky, and that about that the vaccine has come out and all this sort of stuff. Seriously, fuck off. Absolute retard. So when the public servants refuse to serve, then we'll get into that later on in the solutions. That kind of leads into something that I have spoken about previously. But I'll be putting a starting to put a little bit more flesh on the bones around it. So let's get on with it anyway, and get into the first office for this particular ministerial department. And so we're going to go into, first of all, the Charity Commission. Right, so this is Charity Commission for England and Wales, just to be specific. So going on some detail areas first. In terms of, again, when it comes down to these departments all saying that transparency and honest reporting and blah blah blah. So they've got a claim of having an income of 29.3 million, which it's not income, there's one problem. But when you look at the actual income statement that they have, it is 1.8 million, not 29.3 million. So that's wrong. But overall, like I say, I have to go by the figures that they do actually put together. It's obvious throughout everything that I've done already so far, and that these numbers are not going to be correct by any stretch of the imagination. But the number that is going to have to be included within the process is going to be this 27 odd million. So that's the number that's going to go into the process, and that's how I'll take things forward from there. So that we've already got the issue around failure to report correctly. Right, there is an issue with this that I previously stated as well, in terms if when I did the community interest companies, that I'm a little bit lost again as to why this is something that needs to have a separate department outside of Companies House. Because if something is a charity, then it's just a matter of them being able to meet the criteria register accordingly, and then they should be observed in any standard format, any legal fashion. So, you know, oversight, I should say. So whether that is done through Companies House, whether that's done through sort of the legal side of things. I mean, this is something that I had alluded to previously with Companies House, that there needs to be a little bit more involvement on their part in terms of making sure that companies are compliant with the rules and regulations that we then come to determine later on. That will be a much more involved conversation at some point. But the thing of it is, and the reason why it's a problem is because, considering this is all about charity, this, that and the other, then why is this a £27 million burden on the taxpayer for just registering charities? It makes no sense. Now, as much as officially they are supposed to be some kind of oversight, it's quite plain they're really not very good at it, because within their annual report, which links in the description as always, they have got this graphic that I've got just to the side of me here around the number of investigations and compliance issues. Now, when you look at that particular graphic, you do kind of think, well, considering these are supposed to be charities, that does seem like a rather large number of issues that are taking place. But it's worse than that, because within this particular reporting period, the 2019 to 2020, what they have decided to completely miss out on, despite the, as per usual, within, whether it be on their website or within their annual report, you get the usual, you know, the diversity, inclusion and blah, blah, bollocks, all that sort of stuff. And yet they completely ignore, from within charities, the sexual criminals. So whether that, I mean, sexual harassment isn't necessarily horrendous criminal activity, but it depends what you mean by sexual harassment. Because if somebody has literally been abusing somebody physically, that is a criminal act. This type of stuff needs to be highlighted, considering all of the bullshit they come out with. And it's also a bit of a problem around the numbers of paedophiles that are consistently found to be in charities. Again, if you remember when I've mentioned in relation to the United Nations and the charities that work alongside them. Hence why I've put those two headline stories there about the Save the Children and how they mishandle these sexual harassment claims against their senior management, and how Oxfam were criticised over sex claims. Paedophiles is the word that they're looking for there. So you've got all of this stuff about all this diversity, inclusion, and everybody has to be all wonderful, and yet they don't seem to have grasped the basic fact that rapists and pedos deserve a little bit more than being criticised and a slight problem of being mishandling some of the complaints. I mean, this level of utter stupidity. And it does go a long way in that, in terms of identifying the kind of ideology that is within these, within an awful lot of these charities. Because when they will allow people to get away with this sort of stuff, just because they're of the same ideological bent, then you know that you're dealing with a seriously demented, sick ideology. As if we didn't know that already. But when you dig a little bit deeper into the website that they have, and you look at some of the historical cases that they refer to, it includes cases of terrorism. How is a charity getting involved in terrorism? I mean, what these idiots are actually enabling is it goes beyond belief. The people that are in charge of this, probably they need to be bloody held seriously accountable as well, in a criminal manner. So, other issues I've got in terms of charities, because I mean, it is the scenario that you can't tar everybody with the same brush, but my God, there's far too many of these ones that are just off the scale, bloody lunatics. But the charity sector includes these ones that, I mean, I don't know what it's like in other countries. I'm imagining it is fairly similar. But a lot of these charities and that are the ones that are responsible for all this poverty porn that you get all over the television. I mean, there's no stipulation as to where the location of the problem is, or any details as to why it is a continuing problem or anything like that. It's just literally a case of, oh, well, if we just stick a little blackface on the television and go, oh, somewhere out in Africa, then, oh, just give me £5 a month. Yeah, right. This, you know, I mean, if there's no context to what it is that they're then poncing for, then absolutely no chance in hell. That sort of stuff would not be allowed on a television screen, as far as I'm concerned. So, I mean, that will go forward through to things like, what they're called, Ofcom. So, I mean, what sort of individual you've got to be to actually get in touch with these organisations and say, yeah, I'll give you money. I mean, there's something wrong with you in the head. But obviously they're getting an awful lot of money out of this, and there are certain organisations as well where, again, we're supposed to be talking about charities. Now, there's a great long list that I could go through here and that, but I'm just going to pick on one on account of the fact that this is possibly the worst one of all, at least that I know of at the moment. I'm sure I'll come across worse. But considering we're talking about charities, the pay packets that the people that work in these organisations get. So what I'm going to do here is mention a fella called Professor, there's a big shock, Philip Sugarman, who is the chief executive of the St Andrews Healthcare. Yeah, at St Andrews Healthcare. Now, this is supposed to be a charity that's dealing with mental health issues. So, you know, I mean, I'd have problems with that one straight away, but that's a different subject. This fella gets paid £653,000 a year. A charity. I mean, it does smack so much of, was it at some point towards the end of last year when there was disclosure around Joe Biden, and he'd set up a charity that had raised millions and millions of dollars and was found to have actually presented about $200 in charitable donations, and that was all. I mean, seriously, when you're giving to charities of any description, and I even include some of these ones that are around like cancer research and what have you, there's an awful lot of bullshit that you need to seriously be looking into before you give any money to anyone. So essentially what we're dealing with here now is a so-called commission that's supposed to be having oversight of these things that so far from being fit for purpose, that I don't really see any other choice but for all of this to be shut down, abolished and closed. So in terms of the work package within RASIC, it would be a case of having a look in detail to each and every one of the registered charities and find out exactly how they operate and what level of historical criminal behaviour has been taking place, as well as whatever has been going forward as at the time of investigation, and there would most certainly any sort of organisation that have had criticisms and have unfortunately mishandled complaints, things of this nature, these people would literally be arrested and convicted, as far as I'm concerned. Arrested and would follow due process. And if guilty, then convicted. But most certainly, any one of these so-called charities that is taking the piss to the extent that they do, gone. So you'd end up with an awful lot less charities. If there is going to be anything around, something that has got this level of... Because let's face it, it doesn't really matter which part of it that you're looking at, whether it's to do with health or like third world problems or the mental health or, I don't know, like women's, I don't know what you call them, the homes that they have to go, the beaten housewives, this type of thing. These types of organisations that are supposed to be looking after some of what I would actually agree with, because I'm really not a fan of the term vulnerable, because I think it gets far overstated to what it actually should be. But when you do genuinely have situations where you could legitimately say that somebody is vulnerable, to have these parasites feeding off people that seem to think that they're being well-intentioned by offering up money, only for these scumbags to feed their own fat faces and to then abuse the people that they're supposed to be being charitable towards. No. Hell no. And like I said, when you've got a so-called commission that's supposed to have oversight of this stuff and that just won't even recognise it in their own reports, because God forbid it actually shows them to be the fucking idiots that they plainly are. This sort of stuff, I would get rid of it. And that saves us some money as well. It does then put a little bit more substance to something like Company's House. But it wouldn't be overly burdensome. And I don't think it would be something that would create that amount of expenditure and burden to the taxpayer. So, yeah, I would get rid of this particular one. So, here we come into the Ministry of Truth. The National Archives. So, as I said, the initial immediate reaction to me for this particular ministerial department is just get rid of. But we can't really start getting too anal about it, and that we have to understand what really is there. But There are certain parts that have to grab the attention. I mean, obviously that, first of all, the detail and that of the nearly £36 million. And what we are dealing with here, and that is historical information. It's the source of historical information, hence the George Orwell quote. But where I would immediately turn around and say, okay, we do have a problem with this particular department, that means that rather than abolishment, because you can, like I say, I mean, I'm not going to be one of these people that wants to abolish the past, that is going to be well understood because of all of the documentation that you've got in the National Archives. But what I would do is get rid of the sort of crap that you can see, the ideological crap that meets you on the very first part of the webpage that you go to, and the LGBT history, and oh, queer, it's a history of queer, and that, and a picture of it's queer is cool. I mean, seriously, fuck off. That sort of nonsense would be gone. And anybody within this particular organisation that was pushing that kind of bullshit, they would be gone as well. So, I mean, if you've got somebody out there that is saying, okay, we want to dig into some of the records and we want to find out the history of any particular demographic. There's not an issue with doing that. But then it's up to whoever it is that's digging up that information and then presenting it in a factual way, not an ideological way, but a factual way. Then they're the ones that report that information in the way that they have determined it and that they can back it up through the records. It is not for the National Archives to be pushing messages. That is not their responsibility. So, an awful lot of the report that comes with this particular archive office, you can see they give a list of the various things that they're doing which are not part of their remit. And you see the list of the so-called partners and the charities, of course, that they're promoting and saying, oh, look what we've done this year. I mean, it's just literally one ideological group of morons after another. And they are putting it in an annual report to turn around and present that as like that was something that anybody should be proud of. I mean, it's abuse of the truth. It is literally people going in and trying to rewrite history. And this would all have to stop. It's not what the historical records are there for. They're not there to be abused by these people. And certainly not to be assisted by the dipshits that are allowing them to do it. So this is a department that is seriously due for reform. And then obviously in that the cost reductions and that would be achieved by getting rid of all of these ideological morons. Because, like I say, no Ministry of Truth purge to be happening here. Get rid of all of those people. The thing about this place is that, essentially in that, I mean, we are dealing with something that is supposed to be like a library of a fashion. Because not all information, obviously, in that is released immediately. But then that means that the people that work within this department, their role is one of a guardian. They are there to protect the historical documents. Nothing else. I would imagine it would be great for somebody like myself and that I'm the sort of person that puts my records and everything in alphabetical order. So in terms of somebody that's a little bit finickety around that type of thing, I'd imagine it'd be an ideal scenario. But there is no room in these places for them to be pushing the agenda. I mean, the more I look through the government departments, the more sick of them I become. Because it seems like every single office is full of ideological shit. I mean, it's just absolutely disgusting that you've got a bloody conservative government for 10 years that has created this socialist, postmodernist arse dribble. Unbelievable. And that these people will, like I said, they will abuse our past as well as the fact that they are already abusing the present. Outrageous. Very big review and reform. The amount of money that will be saved on getting rid of the ideologues, great. I'm sure there's going to be an awful lot of the people that work in there that will be so glad to see the back of these morons. So, the last department that I'll look at in terms of the three for DCMS today. Now, yet another one that I would absolutely love to get rid of. But there's elements that mean that it's not really practical. So, details first. Funding from two sources on this particular organisation. So you got the larger amount that is from the taxpayer, DCMS, which is a staggeringly large amount of money. And then you've got money that comes through from the National Lottery. That's why I've separated the two. But in terms of the actual process spreadsheets, it'll just be the one figure, the one combined figure. Now, a lot of the figures that they produce in their annual report does seem very much arse about face, and it's one of these scenarios where the method of reporting kind of shines a light on how obtuse somebody is trying to be in trying to hide something. Because again, I mean, the level of proper information that comes with this particular organisation is not up to scratch, put it that way. But once I have managed to at least try to come to realise a certain level of number, when it comes down to the salary of the average salary of all of the people that work inside this organisation, again, it's one of these ones where it's a ludicrously high average of 53,700 for the Arts Council. I mean, no, not at all. But anyway, it's again going because the annual report wasn't very good, as you'd expect for people that are trying to be pushing as much bullshit as they possibly can, but then hiding it at the same time. But what I couldn't help but determine through going through their website was the Culture Change Toolkit. Now, exactly who the fuck ask government to change the culture? What kind of government is it that claims to be, again, conservative? And quite frankly, I wouldn't give a toss what colour they are. Who the hell told them that they're supposed to be putting out some kind of lefty roadmap retard nonsense? Because, as I keep pointing out so many times, the Conservatives are they're not Conservatives. They are literally crony socialists. But who the hell gave these permission to start think for the nonsense that's been going on over the last few weeks, Nat, over that bloody Greta Thunberg and what she's that activist toolkit she sent out to India. What's the difference? Really, what is the difference? Government does not create or decide the culture. The people do. It's as simple as that. So for these bastards to be putting together a culture change toolkit, which, as you can see, if you can see the listing and that, because I know that Rumble, the quality is not so brilliant, so let me just read it out to you. It starts off with a COVID-19 caring for workforce. What the hell's that got to do with culture? Developing meaningful apprenticeships, internships and work experience. Not culture. Designing a person specification. What the hell does that mean? How to diversify proof your policies. Really? Removing bias from shortlisting and selection process. How to carry out performance appraisals. Creating leadership development opportunities to retain talent for future leaders. How to work as an inclusive board. How to collect and use equality information. How is that not indoctrination? Because this is a toolkit that they hand out to all of the little organisations that are poncing off of the taxpayer to go, oh, look at me, I've just done this fucking modern dance that nobody comes to watch because it's bloody stupid. But here you go. Here's your little toolkit as to how you become one of our little useful idiots. Unbelievable. And then literally everywhere again, that you've got the Oh, and it's loaded with every buzzword that you can possibly think of all over this site and that, and all the climate emergency bullshit. Looks like ask any one of these morons the two critical questions and watch them squirm and just go, who's the IPCC? Fucking idiots. These people are just, oh, I hate them, I hate them. Anyway, like I said, I mean, I would love, because of the absolute bullshit that is all over this department, I'd love to say, get rid of a lot of them. But there's an issue. And that issue is the fact that they do have responsibility over museums and libraries. So again, Ministry of Truth. It's part of our history. And it's also part of how things can work for the present generations and future generations in terms of their access to knowledge. So that's, I mean, in terms of a museum, again, it becomes that case of being a guardian. So that's a fairly simplistic remit that an awful lot of museums need to be reminded of again, and that, because I know that they've started trying to do all sorts of crap over here and that, removing people. Anybody that does that, out the door. But in terms of libraries, I mean, it has gone through some changes over the years because of obviously that people's access to the internet and all this sort of stuff, and that they tend not to go to libraries as much as they used to. But that's no excuse for not having a location where you've got the physical product. But I have noted anyway that they do tend to incorporate things like your local registration office and that type of thing, you know, the birth, deaths, marriages and all that sort of stuff. So it is having a kind of a multi-purpose level of development to be able to make best use of the location that they're in, and that's fine. But like I say, having those physical books, records, anything that is there for some sort of learning potential use, and or just even for, you know, the hobbyists, and that's somebody that if you don't want to buy the book and that, and you like the fact that you can just go down and borrow it, read it, take it back, saves you a bit of money. Ideal. But the key thing about it, and that is that, as has been mentioned by others, I think, what's his name? James Corbett? The Corbett Report fella. How he's been pointing out recently, and that about how it's quite easy for people that are maintaining the servers in particular, and any sort of big tech companies that are kind of like being overlords for any kind of historical records, where it's very, very easy for them to delete things from history. You need that physical format. So that's where libraries really come into their own as well. So that physical form has to be maintained, and having something like a library, not just the National Archives, because obviously that's more to do with particularly like the political records and the military records, but in terms of libraries and access for the local people, I think that's something that should be most certainly looked after. Libraries can also be a good option for your home studying. Now, whether that's as an individual or whether that is in like a home study group, so that you can, during the process and that, so that you can avoid the indoctrination camps, you can have these scenarios where you can save, you do a couple of things really, that way you're saving yourself a bit of money by not having to buy the academic books, but you can go there and act as one group in one specific location where you don't have to all be crowded into somebody's house, and it gets you out the door as well, so you've actually got to physically go and get there. There's a few little incentives like that, but being able to go into a particular location where you know that the mindset has got to be, okay, right, now we've got through the door, we're now in the area where we're now going to learn something. So these kinds of useful activities can be put together inside libraries, and libraries can do something to actually help to assist with that, providing that you've got enough staff in there, of course. Not being the teachers, that's not their responsibility, but in order to be able to make sure that the space is there and that they can facilitate it correctly. So these types of things that can be looked towards in terms of maintaining libraries. So I've got a little bit of something in this in my notes here and that doesn't seem to have anything to do with this particular department. So I think I've possibly gone a little bit. I think I'm mixing up two different departments here. Right, so anyway, let's just get back to what needs to be done. So there are potential areas because of the amount of money that is spent on this particular area, where, like I say, I mean, in terms of the types of things that they say that they're supposed to be looking towards developing. So as I've got the list down there, and that the combined arts, which whatever. Dance, music, theatre, visual arts, things of that nature. An awful lot of that, as far as I'm concerned, is not really, again, something that government really needs to be getting too involved with, because a great deal of that type of stuff is there for commercial benefit, basically. So if you've got a dance group, if you've got a particular play to be put on at the theatre or something along those lines, and that, I mean, these are commercial activities, so it doesn't really need the government getting involved in that sort of stuff, because again, culture has got nothing to do with government diktat. So in terms of the best use of the money, and in order to be able to develop some kind of proposition where you can give some incentive to the local population in terms of having involvement within the arts, the two real key populations that this applies to are the youth and then the elderly. And they do both kind of cross over into, I mean, this is basically just me sort of spitballing an idea and as to the best use of money and to be able to include things that are based around the arts. But when I was younger and that, we used to have youth centres. And those youth centres, generally speaking, they weren't very good. It was basically somewhere that people would just hang around and not do an awful lot. I mean, largely play table tennis or some useless nonsense like that. But it was somewhere that kids could actually go and meet up and not just hang around on a street corner, effectively. Something to do. Now, it occurs to me that most of those youth centres have largely gone. There are still some, but not that many. Now, there should be at least one in every town. It doesn't all necessarily have to be based entirely on the taxpayer coughing up for all of it and that, because, I mean, you have all sorts of clubs and that, whether you pay your subs and all this sort of stuff. You just make sure that it is something that is practical and affordable. But what I would do is having those youth clubs put together again so that the kids have actually got an ability to learn the art. So whether it's set up, so for example, having something with a hall so that they can put on their own little events, have the little discos or what have you. But then off to the side of it, you can have certain rooms where they can learn musical instruments, where they can be introduced to like dance classes or anything that's to do with the arts. I mean, literally painting and drawing skills and things of this nature. An awful lot of the stuff that the schools seem to be moving completely away from, which does seem a very bizarre notion to me. So, for example, a lot of the schools out in Asian nations, I think I've mentioned this before, and that where you get the kids that'll go, they'll go to school, and then you have your after-school clubs, which is largely the sports, and then after they've done that, they'll go home, have some dinner, and that, and then they're off to the evening school, which is predominantly based on more study of mathematics and things like that. I'm not condoning that kind of thing. What I am suggesting is that if you've got something where there can be some sort of a physical location for kids to go to, it could potentially include sports as well, but just as a gathering point, and then they go off to the field, wherever, to do the sports. But somewhere where they can have some level of arts education in evening classes, but not done in such a way that it is literally everybody has to sit down and be quiet and like a proper classroom type of thing. Something that's a little bit more enjoyable. Well, that's why I would include things like the music, so that kids can learn how to play the guitar, the drums, bloody clarinet, whatever the hell it is that they want to do. So something that would actually prove useful in terms of skills, creativity, and something that is giving them a little bit more value rather than just sitting in front of a computer all day long, basically. And so you create the social aspect as well then. So then I'd also have something that was to help with the elderly. Now, look at that. I mean, a lot of this stuff does tend to go between sort of arts and social care. I don't really see a problem with combining the two. But one of the key problems that you've got with the elderly is that there's a real problem of them having difficulty in getting out and about, for one thing, and then a real problem around loneliness. So if there is a location fairly similar to like a youth club setup, but just with something that is more suitable for the elderly to actually go there and sit down, have their cups of tea and that, and have a natter together. Maybe if you've got the youth club that's managed to put together a band that has got that can do some music that is some way, it would be difficult to find one, but some way good enough, not good enough, but you know, the type of music that they're putting together and that would be acceptable to the elderly generation. And then same sort of scenario, if they've got the hall there, play the music and that, and the old farts, whoever can actually still walk, have your little dance, you know, do your bingo, do whatever it is and that's going to keep the elderly entertained. But then with them, you'd have to have a very specific vehicle that goes around, like door-to-door delivery type of thing. But have something that is then useful to the elderly. Because so many times you find that the elderly just, they've got nowhere to go. And so in terms of a culture, because like I say, arts is about culture, then a culture of looking after the elderly is surely a good thing. So something along these lines, and that you take out the stuff that should have its standalone commercial capability anyway, so that you haven't got taxpayers paying for some arty-farty crap that nobody wants to go and watch. That's why it has to be funded by the taxpayer. If it can't stand on its own 2 feet, we don't need it. We don't need all of the bloody ideological crap being shoved through this. We don't need to be funding and supporting useless nonsense. We need to be combining the culture that the people themselves are generating and creating and being responsible for, whether you like it or not, and you actually provide the facilities for them to be able to produce that culture of their own. It's up to the people. I mean, you can turn around and then say, well, that's kind of unfair to the people between the youth and the elderly. Well, no, that's what the pub's for. That's what concerts are for. And, you know, you can go out and get your lessons whenever you like. Stick to the ones that need either the education or the care. The rest of the culture will make its own way. That then becomes part of your responsibility, which is another part of culture that is much, much lacking and always missing from anything to do with socialist idiots. So again, it's one of these departments that I would love to be able to turn around and get rid of on account of the fact that they will actually put crap like a culture change toolkit in there. But you take the few parts that are good, like I say, the museums, it's part of maintaining your history. Libraries, it's a part of keeping that physical product and an ability to be able to teach, and then combine it with something that would actually be a practical use to the youth and to the elderly. Have that kind of a setup put in place, and then I think that's something that the taxpayer could actually turn around and say, okay, now you're providing us with value. It's helping with your kids, it's helping with your parents. You know, it's getting them out of your hair for a little bit. After you've, say for example, if you've been doing your homeschooling all day and that, and you've been in the library doing it as a homeschool group, in the evening, off they go and that, and they can go do their music lessons or whatever, and that gives you that bit of a break. And then you can sit down and take your photographs of your dinner and stick it on fucking Facebook. But something that gives people a little bit of... another thing actually in that I should say. In terms of the youth clubs, it doesn't all have to be about the art world. You can actually include having things like sort of creative groups and that, like around like the carpentry and stuff like that as well. Practical skills, all this sort of stuff can be included. You don't have to have it all at some sort of community college or anything like that. The youngsters need to understand these things as well. Good place to do it. So, you know, why not? And especially when you've got some of these older fellas that are very well versed in various types of skill sets, that after retirement and that, they just want a little bit of voluntary work, something to keep them occupied, and they might actually enjoy going out and teaching kids how to do electronics and things of this nature. The two things can actually be quite compatible working together, that don't then end up all having to be taking money off of the taxpayer either. That's proper charity work. That's people giving their time to be able to pass on skills to somebody else. So utilising something along these lines, so that there would be something good to come out of, I'd probably change the name just so I could get rid of all of the morons, but there would be that review and reform. So, like I say, spitballing a little bit, but anyway, so here's the state of play after doing those three, plus last week, and that I showed the main department. So I'm going to do the add up of the departments to see if it meets the total budget that they claim. I doubt it, as per usual, but that's part of what we'll come to find out. So, like I said, they've got the 5 billion that they said that it was, and so far the cumulative 803,000. Like I said, a very large percentage of that going into the Arts Council. Which then leads to the cumulative, still around about 40, I think actually, and that might be a slightly, I might have forgotten to add the numbers for the what are they called, the Charity Commission. I'll have to check on that and maybe update it next week, but anyway, so it would be an abolishment of the Charity Commission, and it would be reform and review of the National Archive and the Arts Council England. Okay, so get there eventually. Slightly rambling and babbling, but that tends to be me all over. So into the solutions part. Again, this is going to be one of these scenarios where you have to be thinking about how things look in your own nation. Because obviously, and that, some of the people that watch this and that are not from the UK. The UK is the model. You look to your own country to find out how it applies for you. Up until now, like I said, I've been saying things like developing your network, the positive trade proposition, something which is a particularly pertinent thing at the moment in terms of this sort of get out clause from the government, turn around and say, no, we're not going to have this immunity passport. No, we're not going to have any sort of internal passport as well, so that you're not allowed to go into the pub unless you've been vaccinated. You're not allowed to go here unless you've been vaccinated. If you've set up a positive trade network and you do have a pub or a restaurant or something along those lines, if they're saying it's not mandatory, but then they're pushing businesses to effectively make it mandatory, they will have no legal position to turn around and say to your pub, it's not mandatory, so there's nothing there to compel you to comply with that. So if you imagine that you've got a sign outside your door that says no vaccine card required, compared to all the other places where all of the other useful idiots have to go, your place will be packed. Simple as that. So, I mean, if you think about it logically, in the UK, so far, I mean, the claims that they're making, they reckon that they have managed to experiment on 15 million people. Okay. There's nearly 70 million people in the country. Which market do you want to go for? Which one of those two? Do you want all of your customers to be coming from the 15 million? Or do you want them to be coming from the, 55 million? Shouldn't be a difficult calculation, really, should it? I'm sure there's going to be all manner of morons out there that go, no, government said. If you're an idiot, that's the path that you'll take. If you're a smart person and you're a business-minded individual that actually cares about providing a service to the public, you will literally put up a sign that says, no cards required here, no information required here. We don't need to take your name and your address and be a little grass for government. We don't need to know if you've been experimented on or not. You're in. Welcome. Here's what we do. That is what the benefit of the positive trade network is. Use your brains. So, these kinds of suggestions that are being made at the moment. But it's fairly obvious that we do have a critical, fundamental problem with politics. All of the changes that we want to see made are not going to happen unless we understand some basic fundamentals. And it applies to all countries. You are going to have the idiots out there that will turn around and say, insofar as the UK is concerned, or any country, they will turn around and say, the ruling party, the ones that are in charge at the moment, they're the ones that were wrong. They're the ones that have tried to destroy the country. No, every single established party has been complicit. Don't ever make the mistake of thinking it was down to a single party. The establishment parties are all exactly the same. They all could not give a shit. That much has been made crystal clear over the last 12 months. So, when you have that kind of realisation, you then have to be thinking, well, how exactly is it that the countries are supposed to be able to move forward when you know that you can't have any faith in the political establishment of any colour? Well, then, first and foremost, you have to understand some of the fundamentals. You have to understand that what needs to be taking place again is that the people in public office remember and are always aware that they are public servants, not public masters. That kind, there's a culture change that the government could actually bother their ass to try to remember. But this sort of stuff needs to be kept in mind and in place for the populace. And you need to understand that all of the different ideologies, agendas, all this sort of stuff, you need to understand exactly where it's all coming from that gets fed through to these established parties that turns them into the useful idiots and corrupt criminals that they are. So, first and foremost, it's a matter of understanding the accountability. So, when you're thinking about accountability and that, it is literally a case of, well, what was in each, what's been in each organisation's, or each political establishment party and that, what's been in their manifestos? And the stuff that they've actually been implementing, and like the stuff that I've been showing you as I've gone through each one of these departments, how much of all that ideological crap was in any manifesto? So if they've been doing stuff that is outside of the remit, outside of the permission of the public that they're supposed to serve, then there's levels of accountability there. And these types of things are critical pieces of information that you need to be able to gather for situations whereby you may need to have some justification for being able to recall some of these buggers. Because across any nation, there's always some method of being able to recall. So it depends on what the timelines are going to be. Because, so for example, in the UK, and I don't think the next election is due until something like around about 2024. I mean, the damage that can be done in that period of time is staggering. So we may not have time to wait for the next election. Oh, we've got the local elections coming up in May, but I don't think that there's going to be an awful lot done around that. I think the Conservatives will get hit hard. But to be replaced by what? This is where the problem comes in. You're more than likely going to end up with a whole bunch of places, particularly up north, that they're going to turn around and say, oh, you know, the Conservatives are arseholes and that, so now let's bring back, put Labour in. Have you seen the morons in Labour? Have you seen some of the absolute nonsense that they're coming out with? They make the lunatics under Joe Biden look halfway sensible. It's just ridiculous. So what you need to be doing one way or the other, and I mean, it could be a case of, with these local elections, just avoid it. Just turn around that. I mean, as much as I've always argued historically to say that it's your duty to go out and vote of some in some shape or form. Try and find somebody. I mean, there's been a number of occasions over the last, since 2010. Every time I've gone out and voted, it's always been for an independent of some description. I've not voted for any of the establishment parties since 2010. So you need to be able to find who it is that you think that you can actually rely on and that is not part of this crony establishment. So what we're talking about here in terms of preparations, because solutions are not always, as I've said before, it's not always swift, it's not always quick. You have to think about how it is that you're realistically going to be able to make any change. I do know that there is the great narrative, I've noticed it out in America a lot recently, where they turn around and say, you can't turn your back on the Republicans because it's a two-party system, you can't do anything about it. Same conversations happen over here. It's Labour and Conservative, you can't avoid it. These blue and red bars, by the way, don't represent any particular political allegiance, just to be absolutely clear on that. But it's a convenient lie that is told. It's a convenient piece of rhetoric that is told to say that you don't have the network, you don't have the backroom ability, you don't have the finance, you don't have this, you don't have that. You've got no choice. You've either got to be Labour or Conservative, Republican or Democrat. All this sort of stuff. And it's just not bloody true. It is just intended to be able to intimidate you to be able to go on one side or the other. and to not even consider trying to break that establishment. And the one fundamental part to it is, irrespective of which kind of system it is that you've got, if you win the most votes in the seat that you're in, the constituency that you are in, you win. It literally is as simple as that. I don't understand why people find that such a difficult concept to be able to comprehend. And this proportional representation thing is just an absolute farce. And all that does is literally stick any kind of decision-making process into absolute turmoil, because you've got a whole bunch of people with completely different perspectives arguing with each other so that nothing ever gets done. Now, it can be suggested that if nothing gets done, that's a good thing. But the kind of changes that most political sort of political arenas, should we say, the kind of change that is required to be able to once again bring it back to public service rather than public master is so clearly drastic. The kind of change that we need is so drastic that we can't rely on this kind of narrative of you can only choose one or the other. We can't rely on the bullshit that's being presented to us to say, well, if we do make any changes whatsoever, and that we'll make sure that you can just have this little bit of decision making. Because we have seen it over here, and that with certain councils that work on a effectively kind of like a proportional representation methodology, and it ends up just an absolute shit show. And if we're really going to make any kind of dent in bringing things back into reality, you've got to take control of those seats. Let the actual people take control of those seats. Not in the as per usual collective socialist idiotic way of taking things forward, but like I say, with this kind of well thought out plan. What is it that your constituency actually needs? And then the people that are running your constituency, what are they supposed to be doing on a local level? And then later on, like with the MP scenario, what they're supposed to be doing on a national level? What's the relationship between your MP and your local constituency, the local council? These types of scenarios, it all needs to be put together correctly. And if we've been following the process so far, where you've developed your networks, where you understand that epistemology, and that is an exceptionally critical part of taking things forward, and you've got a plan of action as to what it is that is required, then you will have developed that network to such an extent that you understand two parts. The first part is that, have you got the numbers to be able to either A, recall your current incumbent and force a by-election, or do you have the numbers that you've counted from your local constituency, you know roughly how many votes you need to have? Has your network developed to the extent that you would be able to turn and say, absolutely, yes, if we go into this, we will win? And they won't be able to cheat us out of it, because we've got that network. We've counted up how many people we've got. If they turn around and say, well, oh, no, suddenly, and that you only, you know, if you're in a constituency where there's 20,000 voters, just as an example, and you know that 10,001 would give you guaranteed victory. But then you turn up on the evening and they're doing the counting and they suddenly say that you've only got about 1,000 votes. You've got your network already to say, no, I've got 10,001 votes. Something's very wrong with this. And you make sure that you can go through that count, and push come to shove, if you've got people within your network that have said, oh yeah, we're absolutely going to support you, but then when they got into the box, decided to go against you, when you're doing the recall, when you're doing the recount, find out who it was. Not to say that there's anything wrong with them doing that, because I mean, at the end of the day, it is their personal decision. But you need to know if your numbers are correct or not. It's literally that simple. Because you've got to be able to go in there with the confidence to say, I know I've won already. So that's one of the key reasons why you need to develop your network. So you're going to understand that when you actually do enter the political process, have you got the numbers to be able to know how well you're going to do? So, as part of being able to take things forward in this fashion, like I said, I mean, one of the key parts is around this, and that is, this is not about mob rule. Okay, just simply making sure that you've got more votes than the others doesn't make it mob rule. It means that you've had a proper plan in place that people actually can agree to. There's always going to be some sort of argument, different point of view and all this sort of stuff and that as you're going through things, taking things forward. But, I mean, you know, that's the whole point of people having the freedom of speech, the freedom of opinion, critical thought, etc. Just making sure that when you're doing it, you're not ending up with some sort of ideological morons. So, as one of the things that you need to be doing in order to be able to put yourself in a position where you can actually win those votes, you need to be looking towards some basic criteria. Now, feel free to add anything else that you think that might be relevant to this. But you can look at it on the two levels. So if you're looking for something that is a person that has got responsibility purely within your local region, then you look towards their regional competence. If you're looking towards somebody that is an MP level, or I suppose in American, like the senator or something like that, somebody that's actually going to be responsible for going into the parliament, as well as looking after your local area, then that person is going to have to understand the regional competences and the national competences. So when you're looking towards deciding who is actually going to be somebody that you can put forward, you need to understand what that competence criteria is before you say, right, this is somebody that we can trust to be able to take things forward. So, in that determination process, first and foremost, obviously, you've got to find people that are actually willing to do this. But if you're starting to have a decent conversation with your network, you're going to do the thing that they're really trying to avoid taking place at the moment and have this social interaction. They're doing their best to be able to keep people apart at the moment. But when you've got your network, when you start developing your network, you start to develop the strength to be able to tell all of these ideologues to bugger off. And you can actually sit down together and start finding out who is a real good potential for this. And then collectively, you can all start saying, well, okay, this particular person has got a good voice, or she's got a good voice. I don't care, I'm not interested in man or woman. I couldn't give a shit, I'm more interested in competence. If the person is good enough and starting to identify that they're good enough and knows enough, and starts to fit within the criteria, that everybody can sit down, that, you know, you can have your own personal little checkbox that you're sitting back and you're listening, and you find that, right, this particular person is starting to sound like a good option, and then you can start to be a little bit more persuasive towards them and say, well, would you go forward with something like this? Oh, go on, have a go at it. Do us a favour, have a crack, you know, something along those lines, and that, to just try to persuade the competent person that you've identified to be able to put themselves forward. Now, it is going to be difficult for any individual to be 100% in every aspect, but then if you look to the qualifications that I've got written down in the regional competence, good support team becomes a particularly important part of that, because never ever have things down where you've got an independent standing for your network that is literally standing on their own 2 feet. You've got to have a few feet below them that are helping to, you know, put them on top of the shoulders of your entire group. So make sure that there's that support team for them as well. But taking things bit by bit. So in terms of your regional competences and that, you want to understand what your geographical knowledge is. So somebody that does actually understand the area. Far too often with the established parties, they parachute somebody in who hasn't got clue one what the local area is like. So you need to be having somebody that has been living within your area, if not born in your area, for a decent period of time. I would suggest something like around about 20, 25 years, something along those lines. Not of age, but period of time spent there. So that they understand what the actual geography of the location that they're representing looks like. The industrial mix part of things, and that in terms of the rural residential industrial mix, that's going to give you a bit of an idea as to what kind of potential support, if any, because like I say, when it comes down to commercial, there should be a very much more of a hands-off approach to this, because it's not up to government. We'd be looking towards going much more towards relative free market, some kind of oversight, but still much more free market based. But understand what those people are, and that's so that later on, when you're looking towards your constituency, the education that's being developed within your area, and that if it's got a base of producing the skills to be able to support that those industries, then you're going to be creating the workforce that can support it and help it have its ambitions later on. So little areas like that. So again, go back to the youth club. If you know that there's, I don't know, like a big woodworking firm in your area and that's doing really well and that, and it supplies various parts of the country, then in your youth club, get one of the guys that has retired from that local carpentry business. Have a word. Who's retired? Who can come over? Teach some of the youngsters, and then they can develop their portfolio. Head over there when there's jobs available and go, right, here's what I can do. That fella taught me. You know, so you're developing that kind of, I hate to use the term circular economy for something like this, but effectively that is essentially what you'd be looking towards doing. So somebody that understands these kinds of perspectives, somebody that is understanding of what kind of resources you have in the area. I mean, obviously in this particular location where I am, you've got the seafront that's close by, and that you've got a port that is really horrendously underused. You've also got like the marina and things like that. So what can be done in terms of locations like that to be able to give more benefit to the local area? What type of people is it that he's represent, that you're representing? He, she is representing. I hate having to fucking say that, but the representative, so that they understand what kind of community is that they're looking at. So again, with your demographic knowledge, you can understand what the age breakdown is and that. So what level of youth support do you need to have? The elderly support do you need to have? Critical, again, your voting population, so that you know when you're putting your network together, what are the numbers that you need? Employment numbers are important to understand, because for one of the key parts that should be at front and centre for anybody is making sure that the region that you're responsible for is getting as close as it possibly can to full employment. Now that can be based on making sure that you've got some kind of a large industrial partner who is not an ideologue, somebody like that coming in and benefiting from the skill sets that you have in your region. It can also be down to having some kind of system where you're giving encouragement for people to be able to start their own businesses, and making sure that people understand that in order for your local community to thrive, you need to be buying from your local businesses, making sure that they are good, making sure that they are presenting quality and something that is of benefit to everybody. So helping each other in that kind of scenario. And so the guy that's representing, understanding what those unemployment numbers are, blah, blah, blah. Getting a good understanding of what your community looks like is going to help you to be able to then develop the programs that are going to be required that ideally are not taxpayer burden dependent, because your whole perspective is being able to reduce the burden on the taxpayer. So then again, so with your sector spread, so like I say, having those unique sectors, and that, so in this location you've got the harbour and the logistics and things like that that could be much better utilised. Having people in whichever location, if you're inland, have you got a particular plot of land and that's got like I say, some kind of energy perspective that you could, not export really, is it, to supply the rest of the country, essentially. Domestic first, international second. So understanding what the unique sectors are and that, and if there are, what kind of logistical advantages or disadvantages do you have? So if you've managed to get if you're in a particular location in the centre of the country, most of the central countries have got pretty good road logistics, but not always. I've noticed in particular out in the southwest that the roadways are really not very good. And then they, like one rail link which goes out to the southwest, which is terrible. So making sure that the logistical infrastructure is able to support the kind of industries that you want to be able to promote for your area. If that means then having to work closely with other regions, then that's what you do to be able to justify, we need this road to be absolutely spot on. If it's currently two lanes but we actually need four, have the bloody thing put in place. Because never ever get put off by all of this crap from people that turn around and say, we need to protect the environment, we need to protect the environment, we can't build anything else, we can't do this, that and the other. 3%. The UK is fairly similar to most countries around the world, and in fact the entirety of the world in terms of built environment. 3%, but just less than 3% is built environment. So for people to turn around and say that, oh, the environment is being destroyed by buildings here, there and everywhere, is absolute bullshit. Again, that then ends up being something that you present actual facts to people, and you don't listen to retards that want to save a couple of butterflies or any nonsense like that. If you need the stuff, build it. The experience of minimum 20 years. This is something that I think is actually long, long overdue. I mean, I get so sick and tired of this nonsense where you have people being promoted, oh, the youngest ever MP, oh, the youngest ever this, the youngest ever that. All that means is you've got an inexperienced moron that isn't going to know what the hell they're doing. That's all it means. I don't give a damn how clever they think they are. If you don't have the experience and the knowledge gained by those years of practical experience, you don't know what you're doing. The earliest age you could possibly have, if you looked at it from the school leaving age of 16, I think in most countries and that it's more like 18, but in the UK I think it's still 16, I'm not 100% on that. But if we said it was 16, the earliest age you could possibly be is 36 before you get anywhere near any of these roles. You've got to know what you're doing. So then your qualifications are fairly obvious realistically. Honesty, integrity, so that good support team. No ideological bents. This is where you do have to start looking a little bit in that into people's backgrounds. If you've had somebody that you've suddenly found out used to be a member of the Communist Party, I don't give a damn what they're like now. Unless they're prepared to literally come out and stand in front of everybody and say 100% disavow, I'll have nothing to do with any of that. I know it's bullshit. I won't have anything to do with it, and make sure they're held to account on it. No ideologues, and no allegiance to the old establishment parties either. But most importantly, make sure that somebody's actually intelligent. Now, when I say intelligent, does that mean that you have to have a degree in it, or a master's or a PhD? No, it doesn't. Not in the slightest. I know lots of people that are incredibly intelligent that have never been to university. And quite frankly, these days, if somebody's been hasn't been to university, it tends out to be a bit of a benefit because they haven't been through the indoctrination bullshit. So somebody that actually has got that practical experience, speaks well, speaks intelligently, can explain themselves properly, knows what they're doing, and possibly most important of all that is understands people and can actually speak to people. That social intelligence is also important. It's not all about what you've got written down on a single piece of paper to say that you sat down and copied somebody else's arse dribble. Have your own critical think. Make sure they've got their own critical thinking and they understand things properly. And above all, that intelligence is also the responsibility intelligence. Okay, so little bits of criteria like this that you can start to build up a pattern of somebody. Obviously, then when you come down to national competence, because if you've got a string of independents that have made up the bulk of all of the constituencies that then become the leading party of in essence, you know, that the leaders of the nation are all effectively independent. Well, then this is something that I will go into a little bit further later on, because it is entirely possible to be able to have independence from each region and each constituency to be able to form a government. It's entirely possible to do that. So what you need to be making sure is that, and it can actually end up being a really positive thing in terms of the progress of the standard of the person that you actually come to put to the fore, really, the one that you want to stand for your region. You then get a bit of a competitive perspective that is the person that you're going to put forward a better candidate than the next door neighbour, or if the Southerners have been taking up so many positions, or the Scots have been taking up certain positions and all that sort, and there you are sat in the north and you're thinking, well, that's not bloody fair, we can put somebody forward that's much better than that. You get that kind of competitive edge to be able to be the best. That is going to be something that's going to help with all manner of innovations and proper progress, not progressive, but progress. That kind of competitive spirit, and that can be quite good. So the person that you put forward has got to have that strength of character. They've got to have the ability to be able to manage other independents in such a way that you don't have to dictate to somebody else. You have that ability to be able to work with them and understand what their needs are according to where they are, but bringing them together for that overriding vision, which comes back to your Sisyphus complex solution, whether that would be part of an overall vision and that, like taking that forward into the stepping stone program, that type of stuff, so everybody understands what you're working towards. So you're needing to have your local vision, then your national vision, and all of the independents need to have a semblance of understanding as to what it is that we're all trying to do as a single nation. You're just taking out the allegiance to a party. That's all you're doing. That's all the difference is. And people need to be able to get their head around that, because it's not this great barrier to entry by any stretch of the imagination. Everybody from a single nation should have the same fundamental willingness for the nation to succeed. That should be their primary goal. So, in terms of their speciality, the reason why you want somebody to have a speciality, not only according to your region, but when it comes down to people being given their designated roles, because first and foremost, now you're going to have like the competition that turn around and say, well, who is the best out of all of these people, and that is actually going to end up being the Prime Minister. So one of them's got to be decided, and I'll go through all of that as to how that takes place at a later date. But you want somebody to be able to be specialised in a particular area in order to be the best candidate to be put forward to running that particular ministry. So you do end up with, for example, somebody that is actually qualified to talk about the NHS or the military, these types of areas, or somebody that can do your bloody arts council or what have you. Somebody that's got the specialisation so that when they go into that department, they actually know what they're talking about. You don't end up with a situation like Matt Hancock, that's in charge of the NHS, who knows jack shit about anything, let alone the bloody NHS. So if somebody's actually got those specialisations, as well as all of the other criteria and abilities, and the support teams will be able to help them in the areas where they're a little bit weak. But if you've got that speciality, then you are nailed on to be getting into that particular role. So being able to turn around and say, right, across the country, this person is ideal for this person is ideal for that, etc., etc. And you will probably find out that as you're going forward, certain regions will be quite dominant in certain ministerial departments. I think it's just something that will end up working out that way. But doesn't really matter. You get the guys, gals, whatever, that can actually perform those kind of specialised areas so they understand what it is that they're dealing with. Part of that specialisation is actually being able to, again, epistemology, being able to understand what facts are, understand how you compile the facts, understand the processes of being able to put together the empirical data to be able to support any kind of proposition that is going to be put forward. So you're not just ending up with, oh, we'll just fancy doing something, making this random change today. No, you're not allowed to do that. You have to present the case. You have to present the business plan that says, right, if I do this, this is what's going to happen, this is what's going to happen, this is what's going to happen. And you're accountable for that. So they need to have that skill set. In terms of their independence, it probably would have been established in the regional competence anyway, but making sure that they're not in, then there's no links and no financial chains, anything that ties these people to any of the agenda mongers that are out there. Because these buggers will do whatever they can, guaranteed they'll do whatever they can to try to be able to wheedle their way back in. That sort of stuff has got to be a part of the process of looking into individuals. I know there's a specific term for that, it's not coming to mind at the moment, but when you're actually looking at somebody as a real good candidate, make sure that they don't have any of those links, or that any historical links to anything like that is long cut. And that ends up part of being the transparency as well. That's that you're making sure that you move into the next stage, incorruptible, that they cannot be got at to be pushing somebody else's agenda. Essentially, with all of them, and that they would, as part of, I suppose I would make this as part of a new process of somebody taking office, that I would look towards them having a contract, essentially like a contract of employment, where their primary responsibility is the duty of care to citizens again. Absolutely nail them down on that, because it's lost. It is currently completely lost. No, none of them seem to understand their duty of care anymore, and the do no harm. These things are fundamental, and I would put that in a contract to anybody. If they've won the election, great. Now, into the room you come, sign this contract. You are now obliged to the citizens that you serve, that you never forget those primary duties. It's always good if you can have somebody that understands what you're doing in terms of the national interest, but then understanding what your potential is and your limitations are in terms of being able to deal with the international arena. So that is in terms of anything that has to be done around the trade relations predominantly, because at the right point I'll go into this in more detail than that, because an awful lot of the stuff that the people when talk about trade is really not necessary. And all these trade agreements, and now they're starting to talk about this bloody TTIP thing again. You don't need any of that rubbish. Look towards being able to go nation to nation, sector by sector. This is what we need. That's what you need. Let's do a deal on that basis. All that's a very simplistic way of expressing it, but these kinds of areas. Now, but people that have got some level of understanding as to how you actually do go out and have conversations in the international arena. Everything that you do, irrespective across the board, again, as I said, the cost benefit driven. Provide anything that you're going to be putting forward, you present that business plan and you make sure that people understand it. This is the justification for what it is that I'm doing. This is how it will actually benefit the country, the region, the sector, whatever it is. Have that information there, ready, available. Do it as a business should be done. Running a nation is not entirely, completely redundant of business process. These things do actually go hand in hand. So the taxpayer focused, again, is that it's remembering that fundamental understanding that when I would get so sick of people that turn around and say government money. Oh, the government is going to give me money. Oh, the government is going to give money to this. The government is going to give money to that. No, they're not. They're giving taxpayer money away. Now, I understand that from the fiat currency, you can potentially say that it is government money, but the fiat currency is dependent on passing the burden of debt onto the children that haven't yet been born. So it's still taxpayer burden. So everything that has to be done, or anything that has to be done, or anything that is going to be done, anything that's going to be considered, you think about who it is that you're taking your money from, first and foremost, and you never ever use the term government money again. You say taxpayer money. This is your money. That's why you're a public servant, because they're the people that are giving you the money to do the things that you do. Everything has to be based on making sure that people's freedoms are maintained across the board. That is something that I'll go into a little bit later on when it comes down to the a change in the role of an MP. Because as things stand in that, so whether it, I think in most countries it's pretty much a very similar type of scenario, where you have the MPs that were sitting out in Parliament and that, and they're basically all just talking bullshit all day long and that, to be able to come up with yet another new law. There is absolutely no purpose at all in somebody whose entire position is based on creating more restrictions, because when you have more and more laws being created, essentially all you're doing is creating further and further restriction on the public that you're supposed to be serving. That has got to stop. An MP's role is not based on restricting you each and every day that you go into the office. It's supposed to be about benefiting people, of making sure that things run correctly, about making sure that I mean, you have all the bullshit use of the terms and that, but things like the health and well-being of the nation, rather than just having that as some throwaway comment that then nobody ever actually then fulfills, have it as something that is actually a part of the credo, something that is built into the contract. This is what you're actually supposed to be doing. Now, if you end up in a situation that everything is running so bloody smoothly that you've got very little to do, maybe that frees you up to do something else. But you make damn sure that everything is running very smoothly before you do that. Because the number of people that you're effectively going to be responsible for, I'll guarantee that your days are going to be filled. I mean, anybody that wants to put anything else out there in terms of what the the competence criteria should be. No, crack on, like I said, always say it, this isn't about Paulism. It's about what does everybody think would be ideal criteria for somebody. Now, does this also have to be something that we're going to be so hell-bent on putting out a list of characteristics that becomes so absolutely improbable that you are really going to struggle to get somebody? You have to be realistic. Like I say, that's kind of why you got the good support team involved as well. We're not expecting anybody to be so absolutely almost godlike. I mean, it's just not practical. That's why I think the lists that I've got here and that are not beyond the realms of expectation. So I wouldn't be happy to just take a whole range of different suggestions of what characteristics there should be so that you end up with a list so bloody long that it would probably take 10 people to fill it. So we keep it at least relatively condensed enough in order to be able to maintain a sense of reality. The one thing that we don't do in either criteria is throw in identity politics. It's irrelevant. It's irrelevant in all things anyway. It's about competence, not identity. So, like I say, I mean, is this again a sort of like a reach for utopia? Yes and no. No, predominantly, because this isn't about suggesting that, like I say, that each individual is going to be sort of godlike and everybody's going to be doing everything absolutely wonderfully. That's not realistic. That is not the real world. But is it something that is being able to establish some kind of mechanism and criteria and process and perspective and thought process for that I think people can realistically understand and get their head around without it being so hugely overwhelming that it does have areas around it that I think we could actually look towards taking forward to, like I say, not a perfect model, because nothing is perfect, and would there be some areas in that where you would come across certain issues of too many people being specialised in too few areas, things of this nature? You might find that kind of problem. It's not completely infallible, but that's why you would end up with something that you're looking towards tweaking and making better as you're going forward. That's the whole point of progress. This is. I'm not suggesting something that is literally out of the realms of possibility. Finding the right people for the job is a fundamental part of what this is about. Making sure that people have developed their network so that everybody is of the same mind to say, well, we all want what's best for everybody. And we're not going to be lied to and have people put in their ridiculous ideologies that spew out pseudoscience, that pump us full of propaganda, and that has everybody sitting in their house going, I don't know what the hell's going on. You're basically taking back some level of control, but doing it in a focused, workable fashion that does have the building blocks of a realistic proposition. so in terms of a solution, like I said, I mean, this is something that obviously not because you're talking about having still maintaining a parliament, still maintaining a political process. So therefore, you are still looking towards what is fundamentally a mixed economy. And when you're looking towards something that is a mixed economy, you're looking at something that is not out of kilter, not out of kilter with that which people have become accustomed to. It does mean that more and more people are going to have to be, as I've alluded to in the first place anyway, more responsible, more engaged, understanding that the freedoms that you all want to enjoy do come with, you know, a level of weight that has to be lifted. But my God, if you start working towards something along these lines, it's, you know, anything that then goes wrong is your, it would then be our fault that we can then fix without having to wait for some blonde fat retard telling us whether we're allowed to or not. You know, so I mean, in terms of a solution and that, I mean, is this something that is a solution that can be done now? Yes, it is. It is something that you can actually start working towards now. And realistically, like I said, I mean, in terms of the UK, if people were to really start considering this properly, by the time the next election comes around, you'd be ready. You would be ready. Do I think that's going to happen? Probably not. You know, 12 viewers on Rumble doesn't really get you far. But you know, somebody's got to come up with some sort of bloody ideas for this stuff, haven't they? That's all I'm trying to do. Trying to put things together and that seem to have some sort of logic, process, methodology behind it. Something that people can actually have a conversation about and to see whether there are areas that could have some practical application to it. So that's essentially what I'm looking towards doing here. So yes, it is something that could be started and worked towards immediately at any point. Would I be somebody that fits into the criteria that I talk about? Probably not. So whenever I've had political conversations with people, now I can be a little bit forceful with it. So I tend not to be too brilliant with the managing of various opinions. I'm okay when I get it sort of fed to me in bits and pieces, and I can process it all and understand where the reality is in certain things and that, but I think I'd probably end up being a little bit too dictatorial. But beyond that, one of the other key aspects to it is that the person that comes up with the process should not be the person that implements it. Potential for oversight, make sure that it's going the way that it should do and providing some assistance along those lines. Possibly, yes. In terms of being the person responsible for it, probably not. Because otherwise, that's where ideologies are born. You need that different point of view. You need somebody that is possibly a little bit more amiable towards others than I generally tend to end up being. So, anyway, that's the Ministry of Truth episode for what it's worth. As I say, we've gone through the three departments of DCMS. There's 45 of them to be got through in total before we come to the end of that. And, you know, hopefully, again, there's some level of useful information. I'm trying not to go into too deep a dive with each of the officers, at least in these episodes, anyway. Because I know that it can be quite burdensome, especially on me as well. Like I said, when I've had to do some of those departments in BEIS, like the Malborge one and that, when I had to do episode 19, I had to split it into three different episodes. I mean, it can end up being a little bit too much of a deep dive. If I come across something where I think it's absolutely critical, then yeah, fair enough. But I want to try to keep things moving along as things stand. So anyway, that's where we stand. So episode 29 will be continuing to move forward, and I'll try to flesh out a little bit more on the solution side as well, so you get a better understanding of what it is that I'm actually proposing for the all of the seats being independent and being able to do something in a national interest basis. So anyway, do all of the usual that I don't like to mention, and because I'm on Rumble, so it's not really necessary anymore anyway. But anyway, spread the word, send it around, do whatever, contribute, speak your mind, and I shall see you next week. Have a good week. Take care. Bye bye.